Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Exotic Astrology, Bhagavad Gita playlist. We are back with it again. And we reach the 18th verse of the second chapter in our last video. So I will read the 18th verse once again, the translation. The material body of the indestructible, immeasurable, and eternal living entity is sure to come to an end. Therefore, fight, O descendant of Bharata. Krishna is referring to Arjuna here. So now we shall start with the 19th verse. And there's a lot of mention about killing here. Okay. So therefore, the 19th verse is very important because, of course, this verse should be interpreted in the right context. Otherwise, this can create havoc if it is misunderstood. All right. So let us offer our prayers to the preceptors who have blessed us with this divine knowledge. Om Agyan Timirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah. All right. So 19th verse from the second chapter. Ya enam veti hantar. Hantaram yas chainam manyate hatam ubhau tau na vijnanito nayam hanti na hanyate. Neither he who thinks the living entity the slayer nor he who thinks it slain is in knowledge, for the self slays not nor is slain. Wow, we need to read it again. Neither he who thinks the living entity the slayer, nor he who thinks it slain is in knowledge. For the self slays not, nor is slain. Complicated, right? Let us see what is there in the purport. When an embodied living entity is hurt by fatal weapons, it is to be known that the living entity within the body is not killed. Why is the living entity not killed? Because the living entity is spirit soul, Satchit Ananda. Nobody can actually kill the living entity. It's the body which is getting harmed. The spirit soul is so small that it is impossible to kill him by any material weapon, as will be evident from subsequent verses. Nayanam chindanti shastrani. These verses will come, okay. Nor is the living entity killable because of his spiritual constitution. So, not only we cannot kill the living entity, the soul, by using any material weapon, but by using any other means, it is also not possible outside of material nature, because the soul has nothing to do with the body actually, and the soul is indestructible. So, nor is the living entity killable because of his spiritual constitution, because the living being is totally spiritual. Has nothing to do with matter. What is killed or is supposed to be killed is the body only. All right, so only the body is getting killed, not that the person is dying actually. But we say, oh, he died, she died. So actually, what we mean is that actually, what it means when we say somebody died, it means that that person has left this particular body and then gone to another body. Okay, that is what it means when we say this person has left. But actually, that person never dies. That person is always there. And that is what Krishna is telling to Arjuna in the previous verses and now and later also. When Arjuna is concerned about killing Drona, Bhishma, okay, that you can never kill them because they are spirit souls. So, and if you talk of the body, one day the body will anyways perish. So you cannot preserve the body for very long. So by your killing Drona and Bhishma, it is not that you are killing them. Okay, you are just killing their bodies. And by your not killing, it doesn't mean that their bodies will stay. So that is why it is very easy to cultivate detachment. Once we know this fundamental principle of spirituality, which the Gita explains us very beautifully, nor is the living entity killable because of its spiritual constitution, because the spirit soul is Sat Chit Ananda, which means full of eternity, knowledge and bliss. The spirit soul is eternal. That is why you will always feel that why does nobody like to die? If you ask any person, would you like to die? Nobody will say yes. Why? Because the so-called death is actually against our nature, which means our nature is to be eternal, Sat Chit Ananda. But when we are linked to this body, then there is something, some experience like death, because of which we feel that we will become non-eternal. That is why everybody runs away from death. But the problem is, but the good thing is actually not that we cannot die. We are always eternal. So we will not stay in this body for eternity. So maybe I am making this video, and maybe after 100 years, if by God's grace YouTube is there, maybe I am not there when some of you are watching this video. So I am making this video today, 16th February 2020, and I don't know when it is 2090, will I be there? But if somebody is watching this, then maybe I will be there in some other body, in some other universe or anywhere maybe. But I will always be there. I will be there. Whoever is watching this video, you will always be there. You will never die. So congratulations on those lines. What is killed or is supposed to be killed is the body only. So the body deteriorates when the soul leaves. That is why even somebody touches, even if your husband or your wife with whom you have stayed for the last 50 years of your life, even if the husband dies or the wife dies, if your partner touches your dead body, then after that they will go and wash hands, okay? Because the dead body is considered to be very contaminated. And scriptures advise us that whenever we go to any crematorium or to any house which has a dead body, we should always go and take bath immediately before doing anything, because it is very contaminated to go to such a place. Not that we should not go, but we should take proper precautions once we come back home. Otherwise, that energy permeates through the entire house, okay, which is not very good for us. This, however, so what is killed or is supposed to be killed is the body only. Okay, now is the important part. This, however, does not at all encourage killing of the body. Okay, so now you cannot go and, if you are angry with somebody, you cannot go and tell the person, oh, sir, actually, I'm angry with your body, can I just kill you? Okay. The Vedic injunction is Ma Himsayat Sarva Bhutani. Ma Himsa, it's Ma Ahimsayat, actually. MAA. Never commit violence to anybody. Never, never, never. Okay. As the famous saying goes, Ahimsa Parmo Dharma. Never commit violence to anybody. Okay. This violence means many things, actually, not just physical violence. So one thing is we go and kill somebody. The other is we go and beat up somebody. Or the other is we just slap somebody. Or the other is we don't touch somebody, but we insult that person. Okay. Especially we should never do that to anybody, but especially to our elders and to our seniors and to our gurus. Okay. But that is the predicament of the age of Kali, that I have seen people going and disregarding or disrespecting their own gurus who have given them spiritual knowledge. I wonder what is the faith of these disciples or these people. Lord Narayana will never accept you if you do that. The worst of the worst of the worst aparads that you can commit in your spiritual journey is Guru Avagya. That is the worst thing that you can do. Okay. Because the word aparad means, radha means aradhana, which is worship actually. And apa means that which takes you away from worship. Okay. So when you do aparad, especially when you insult somebody, in the insult any great personality, okay, either that person is living or from the past. So suppose somebody insults Arjuna or Yudhishthira Maharaj, even then that is a very big aparad, okay. Or you go and insult some god brother from your spiritual community, or you gossip about them, or you blaspheme them, or you criticize them, or you insult them, whatever it is, or even a god sister or anybody, in fact, okay. There are severe karmic consequences, and aparad has two consequences basically. One is you get reaction at a material level, you will suffer very badly, but your spiritual progress also shrinks. Okay, so if you insult a normal person, then you just get some materialistic reaction, which means somebody will insult you in some lifetime. Okay. But if you insult a great personality, a great soul who is connected to God, then the reaction in a mundane sense is also 1,000,000,000 times more, and your spiritual progress also shrinks. Okay, because then God personally takes care of you, He will not spare you if you do that. Okay, so please stay away from aparad. Guru Avagya, that is the highest level of aparad which you can commit actually. It's like insulting the Guru only. Never commit violence to anyone. So, yes. Nor does understanding that the living entity is not killed encourage animal slaughter. Very, very, very important here. The topic of animal slaughter has come. Killing the body of anyone without authority is abominable and is punishable by the law of the state, as well as by the law of the Lord. So, if you go and kill somebody without any authority, then you will be punished by the government and also by God. Arjuna, however, is being engaged in killing for the principle of religion and not whimsically. All right. So Arjuna is doing this as a duty to protect Dharma, because the Kauravas, headed by Duryodhan, Shakuni and Dushasan and Karna, these four great personalities, members of the Duryodhan and company. One is the CEO, other one is the COO, other one is the managing director, and other one is the trustee, maybe. Stakeholders of this company, you know, Duryodhan and company. So these four great personalities, these Mahapurush, they're all Mahapurush, you know, the kind of deeds they have done, my God. So they deserve to be killed, because they don't deserve any mercy, because they have committed every heinous crime that anybody can do. Murder, trying to murder somebody. They tried to do that to Bhima when he was very young. Okay, they insulted Draupadi. Then they tried to violate her chastity, and they ripped the Pandavas of everything that they had, and made them into paupers and beggars. And they had tried to burn the Pandavas, including Mother Kunti, in Varnavrat. Alright. So, as Krishna says in Gita, Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam dharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham, that I descend time and again to kill the miscreants. So, the Kauravas or anybody who has assembled in the side of the Kurus, okay, in the war of Kurukshetra, they are all siding on the side of Adharma. So their death is the need of the hour, because if these crooks, they survive, then they will ruin it totally. All right. Now imagine if Duryodhan would become the emperor of the world, what would happen? I mean, we can't even imagine. All right. So therefore, Krishna made sure that he installs great personalities like Dharmaraj, Yudhishthir and the Pandavas, Arjuna, Bhima, Nakul, Sahadev, in the throne. And finally, after the Battle of Kurukshetra, they were coronated as the Yudhishthira Maharaj was coronated as the emperor, and then Bhishma Pitama was also very delighted and he also left. So therefore, this verse does not support any whimsical killing, okay? Because unless the killing is sanctioned by Krishna, it is mostly whimsical. So many times people go and say that, oh, actually, you know, animals were meant for eaten to be, where they were meant to be eaten by human beings. Okay, so that is why we can kill them, actually, you know. So it's fine to kill animals, actually. There's no problem, all right? But the problem is that idea is not sanctioned by the scriptures, all right? You will get severe reaction if you participate in animal killing. Now, somebody told me one day that, actually, you know, I don't go around killing animals. One of my relatives, actually. And she asked me a question. I just go to a restaurant and I just order some chicken or some mutton or some pork or some beef dish. And then I just go and eat it. Okay, so I'm not going on killing that animal. That animal is already killed. So will I still get karma? Well, of course you will get karma, 100%. It is said that anybody who participates in animal killing or any killing in general, the sin is divided into six parts. You know, one who sponsors it, one who sees the animal being killed, one who kills it, one who buys it, one who transports it, one who eats it. Okay, so there are like six or eight criteria like this. And therefore, if we think that we go to any hotel and we order some meat dish, so, and we eat it and we think we will not get any karma, well, we are in dreams, actually. We are in an illusory world, because God is not happy when you go on killing his children. Okay, so imagine there's a family with three kids, okay, and then one kid goes and tells the father, actually, father, you know, this second brother which we have, you know, he can't speak much, he can't do much, you know, he's just hovering around, you know, would you mind if I just go and kill him? So what will the father do? The father will give you a tight slap and he will throw you out of the home, right? So that is what God does exactly, okay? So therefore, we may not be able to see the precarious situation of people, those people who are committing violence towards animals, we may not be able to see that literally, directly, which means it will not happen necessarily that today you eat meat or fish or eggs, okay, all three are included in this, and then you in the night you will get some heart attack and you will die. Okay, it will not happen like this. It will happen gradually. When the time has to come, only then you will suffer, all right? So don't think that, oh, nothing is happening to me, I'm eating and nothing will happen to me. Well, of course it will happen, because you are depriving somebody of their freedom to live. How would you feel if somebody would come and, you know, take a knife and chop your head off? How would you feel? Imagine, just think what happens when you see a snake or, you know, any animal who is running after you, you know, even sometimes dogs barking. How do you feel? We feel very fearful, because we want to live. And similarly, the animals also want to live, all right? So therefore, we do not have the authority to deprive anybody of their freedom to live, okay? If we don't like that, then they also don't like that, okay? And this is the reason why we should stop eating meat, fish and eggs. There are many other reasons. Environmental degradation is happening. Health is degrading, but those are secondary reasons. That is not important. What is happening to environment is secondary, and what is happening to your health is also secondary. Most important thing is it is their freedom to live. You cannot deprive them of their freedom to live. If you do, you will get karmic consequences for that. All right? So, now, why do you do that? Because it gives some pleasure to your tongue. Well, that is what Krishna says in the Gita, that materialistic pleasure is like nectar in the beginning and poison in the end, okay? So therefore, this meat which you are eating will lead to your downfall one day, and that will totally destroy you. It will destroy. And the worst thing that happens when you eat meat is, because meat is in tamoguna, because it's like, you know, imagine when an animal is killed, you know, it's like so much adrenaline is there in that animal's body, you know, so much fear, so much hate, so much anxiety, that also comes to your consciousness. And because of that, the tamoguna inside you also increases. And have you seen people these days? You know, they cannot sit peacefully for even a second. They are, you know, indulging in extramarital affairs. They are watching pornography. You know, they are not able to retain their semen. You know, they are going on flirting with members of the opposite sex. Nowadays, maybe same sex also. You know, and they're just going on doing whatever they want. You know, it's like, as the Bhagavatam says, you know, manorathena sati dhavato bahi. They are just going on in the chariot of their mind. Today the mind is telling, oh, this person is handsome, this person is beautiful, you know, so I want to enjoy with him, I want to enjoy with her. Okay, but what about your husband? What about your wife? Oh, no, she's not that great, he's not that good. So now I will change my partner, okay, because I don't like this person. So throw him out of my life, just kick him out, right? So if we are insensitive towards animal killing, then we will also be insensitive towards other human beings who are there in our lives, okay? So therefore, now it does not mean that the moment you stop eating meat and you become a complete vegetarian, you will become be liberated. Okay, it doesn't mean that. That is the beginning. That is level zero. Okay, a spiritual progress without stopping this meat eating, it is simply illusion. Okay, so if you are a victim or if you are plagued with this habit of meat or fish and eggs, quote unquote disclaimer. Then, and if you are interested in any kind of spiritual elevation, which is very obvious, otherwise maybe you are not watching this video, right? Because my channel is on astrology. But if you are watching the Bhagavad Gita series, which means you have some level of inclination for spiritual progress, okay, or you at least want to know what spirituality is, then it is my humble request that you give it up completely. Doesn't matter what the doctor says. Doesn't matter what anybody else says. Doesn't matter how delicious it is. It is poison and it will ruin your consciousness. All right. So protect yourself. So eating meat, fish and eggs should be given up not more for the animals. Actually, it's more for yourself because it's ruining you. The animal is dying. That is there. But it is also ruining you. So why are you ruining your own life? Okay. So don't ruin yourself. Elevate your consciousness and take sattvic food, you know, pure vegetarian food. That is very good for you. And that will help you in elevating your consciousness. So that is like the base. Okay. When you do that, above that, you can do activities like, you know, you can chant mantras, read scriptures, take darshan, take prasad. You can go to holy places. You can do all this. But if your eating habits are not in accordance to the scriptures, then whatever else you do, it doesn't show any results, okay? It will not have any effect, all right? So therefore, you know, we need to understand that we should stop committing any kind of violence, okay? Either it is killing or either it is verbal abuse also, all right? So be respectful when you say things to people. You can disagree with somebody, that's perfectly fine, but you should not go and blaspheme that person, insult that person, okay? Even if the person is a gross materialist, even then we should not do it, okay? And what to speak of if somebody is connected with a spiritual community or is trying to elevate his or her consciousness spiritually, then the reactions are multifold, all right? And the plus point is your spiritual progress also goes down when you do that. That's like an added, that is the main thing actually, okay? The materialistic suffering or the reaction which you get is secondary. That is the main thing. When you do aparad, then all the spiritual progress shrinks and it's over totally, okay? You can chant a million mantras. You can pray to God a million times. He will never, never, never listen to you if you commit aparads towards great personalities and to sadhus especially, and also personalities from the scriptures, okay, like Prithu Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj, Ambarish Maharaj, Yudhishthira Maharaj. Then we have Arjuna, okay, then we have Draupadi, then we have Kunti, then we have Anasuya, then so many, you know, so many great sages. So we should be very respectful towards these personalities, okay, and not just whimsically speak anything like dogs sometimes and then think that we will make spiritual progress, okay. So therefore, we should be respectful to people and we should try to not commit any kind of violence. Okay, there's a shloka in the Gita which will come later. Anudvegam karam vakyam satyam priyam hitam chaya. That shloka is there, but that's very far. Okay. So I know whatever I have spoken here is very strong, and maybe I have also committed some violence towards you. Maybe the words have pinched you, but I'm very sorry if that has happened, but I need to speak the truth. Okay. So therefore, it is highly essential that we stop committing violence towards others. Okay. Otherwise, we don't commit violence towards others. When we are committing that, we are committing violence towards ourselves actually, because finally that karma comes back. Okay. And our consciousness is ruined totally. All right. So if we want to have any spiritual aspiration in the future or even in the present, then it is highly essential that we give up meat, fish and eggs completely and adapt to a sattvic diet. Okay. Otherwise, our spiritual progress will simply happen in our mind. We will think that we are elevating, but actually we have not even started. All right. Thank you very much. And if you're new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you have not watched the videos in this playlist, then please watch them serially. And if you want a consultation from me, you can always go to the website down in the description section of my videos. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. Thank you very much.